Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa salatu wa salam ala sayyid al-anbiya wal musaleen wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. You guys can hear me alright? You can be okay? Okay. Well, I just want to tell you how awkward this is first. What I do on campus with my students, if a student walks in late, I give them a standing ovation and make the entire student body give them a standing ovation for a good 5 minutes. So I just got paid back for what I put my students through for several years. But anyway, I'm going to be sharing some thoughts with you, inshallah ta'ala, in this brief, these brief moments we have together about the future of youth activism. I've talked about this subject many times, but there are some thoughts that I think everybody here, I see some elders here and I see some young people here, that I think it's important for us to think about, and inshallah ta'ala, I hope I have some clarity and some organization of thought in what I have to share with you. I want to begin with the idea that alhamdulillah, we're blessed with a country and we're blessed with Muslim communities across this country that have some really talented young people that have been serving their communities, and they've been trying to do things on college campuses and in high schools and at the masajid and volunteering, whether inside the masjid for educational organizations like Sunday schools and Islamic schools or Hibs schools, or at, you know, youth programs and youth halaqat and those sorts of things, or even outside of that in political groups or action committees or, you know, a humanitarian effort. So we have, mashallah, really good contingent of young people that are doing some pretty amazing things. More and more conferences are being put together, and a lot of the people, probably most of the people that have, that are the backbone of putting those programs together, are young people. And this is a new phenomenon for the ummah. It's actually a pretty difficult, pretty different trend for the Muslims, and it didn't look like this 50, 60 years ago. Anywhere in the Muslim ummah, you did not find the Muslim youth carrying the load or doing most of the work. It was actually the elders that were more so involved in religious activism. So alhamdulillah, we are actually at the forefront of something pretty awesome. But we need to take some serious steps. The reality of it is, as many people as are here, mashallah, sitting inside this very warm hall, as many people as are here, there are so many more Muslims in this community and many other communities across the country that are basically not interested in Islam. And it's not just Islam, they just don't see the point in religion altogether. They just don't care. They're not evil people. They're not bad people. I mean, some people call them liberals, some people call them progressive, some people call them, you know, ignorant or not knowledgeable in deen, etc., etc. I don't use any of those terms. I just say those people were raised in a society where they saw that religious people, people that were religious, are very harsh. People that are religious are very judgmental. People that are religious are very to themselves. They have their own cliques and their own clergy, and they stick to that, and they just keep everybody else out. They look down upon others that aren't as righteous as they themselves are. Or people that are religious are just plain backwards. I'll say that last one again so it hurts a little more. Religious people are just backwards. They're unsophisticated. They're not very, you know, thought-provoking, and they don't care about career or advanced education and things like that, right? So for example, and some of this is in America, most of this is across in the rest of the ummah. For example, where I come from originally, from Pakistan, a guy with a beard is probably a guy who probably doesn't care about his education much. A guy that you see at the masjid for Fajr must not be a guy that's gonna do something big ever in life. He's probably just gonna, the most he's ever gonna do is leave his home for a few weeks to do da'wah or something. Or, you know, this guy is not gonna accomplish things in life. That perception of religion has to be shattered. That perception of Islam has to be shattered. Islam is a means by which people are empowered. They're empowered to do amazing things for their deen, but that through that deen, they're also empowered to do amazing things for their dunya. Their dunya becomes full of blessings because it's guided by their deen. They're the people that are able to launch the most successful and powerful and ethical institutions, organizations. And I want to just kind of bring this down to earth a little bit before I share my actual ideas with you. How many people here work in corporate America? In corporate America, okay. Now, in large corporations, for example, you're a consultant, or your company has a contract with the government. After all, we are in Virginia. right? Your company has a contract with the government. And when you have a contract with the government, maybe your services are contracted for 6 months to finish a project. You can finish the project in 3 months, 2 months even. You're done. So you go to your manager and say, I'm done. We should let our client know that we're done. We got 4 months of nothing more to do. And your manager says to you, relax. The contract is for how long? 6 months. They're going to pay us another 4 months, and we're going to bill them $1,000 an hour or whatever. Why would we tell them we're done? Why would we take 6 months of money and reduce it to 2 months of money? Just relax, just stay on your computer, memorize some Quran if you want to, take extra long breaks for Jumu'ah, you know, just sit there and watch Islamic YouTube videos, I don't care. Just sit there, relax, you don't have to worry about it. You know what? That is at the heart of the corruption that happens that the government won't come after you for. It's not illegal, it's just plain unethical. It's unethical. And Muslims that are actually educated in their religion wouldn't stand for it. They'd have a problem with that. So if they can't change that in their company, they're going to start a company that doesn't do those things. They're going to become employers that have ethical standards. They're going to hold themselves to a higher standard. What am I trying to tell you? Even the world around us, where we see sophistication and development and the allure, young college students feel like, man, I can't wait to get a high-paying job. You can't wait to get that. You can't wait to get the car, the apartment, to be able to say, I'm starting out at this company or that company. You know? Even though that allure is there, corruption is still there. The corruption in the Muslim world looks like dirt on the streets. It looks like, you know, cops that are pulling you over and they're basically charging you the fine right then and there in cash. And then they let you go. That's what the corruption looks like in the Muslim world. But the corruption in the sophisticated world is a lot more subtle, but it's still there. Muslims with the right education will stand up against corruption. They'll create institutions that do not allow for any form of corruption. So this is the kind of thing we have, this is the kind of generation we have to create. In these 10 or 15 minutes that I want to talk to you, I just want to talk to you about how are we going to build that generation. And this talk of mine is it's based on a couple of things. It's my studies in deen, but it's also my observation of our own community. Just what I've seen across the country and what I think, Allahu Ta'ala A'lam, what I think is the way forward for our youth, for the young people. And some of you that are sitting in this audience, I'm talking directly to you. And some of the elders, I'm talking about your children. The fact of the matter is, we as a people revolve ourselves around role models. Muslims are obsessed with role models. This is not our fault. It's the beginnings of our ummah. Our first role model is Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. After him, it's the Khulafa al-Rashidin al-Mahdiyin. They became our role models. After them, the great stellar scholars of Islam became our role models. We learn their lives, we study their heroism, we study their character because we want to emulate that character. We have always been a people that gravitate towards role models. Obviously, in the modern world, the thing to aspire towards, the thing that people gravitate towards, are institutions and brands. Right? So people want to go to Harvard. They don't know any single professor at Harvard. They don't have a role model at Harvard. They just like the Harvard brand. They want to go to Harvard. Somebody wants to go buy, a Mercedes. They don't know the name of the engineer who made it. They just like the brand Mercedes. So it's institutions and brands that people come towards, not individuals. But the Muslim community, us, even in 2013, we still gravitate towards who? Role models. We still gravitate towards role models. Whether we have role models as scholars, da'is, khatibs, you know, people find a person and they say, that person's amazing, that's a role model to me. I want to listen to them, I want to learn more from them. That's what we do. And I say that that's not necessarily a bad thing. It can become a bad thing, but it's not inherently a bad thing. What we have to learn to do to save our youth is we have to produce young role models. We have to produce young role models. The idea of what does it mean to produce a role model is not to produce a khatib. It's not to produce a guy or a young man or a young woman who's going to speak at Islamic conferences. That's just one kind of service. There are many other services that need to be provided. But in all of them, there needs to be some common elements of education. Those are the ones that I hope in the next maybe 7-8 minutes I can present to you. In my opinion, whoa, that is huge. Wow, mashallah. Yep, and it's going to the sister's side, which is even better. Yep, that's gonna happen. That's what happens. The most exciting thing that'll happen in today's program, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, what was I talking about? Something about the story of Adam alayhi salam or something? What was I talking about? Role models? Okay. I gotta tell you a funny story since it came in my head, so I just gotta share it with you. You know, I just met with some family, and a lot of my family's from Pakistan, and they barely know English. They barely know English. And my uncle once told me when I visited him, he goes, "Hey, Nouman, you came from New York. You didn't bring any role models?" And I was like, "You want me to bring you a role model from New York?" He goes, "You know they sell the role model at the airport?" "Oh, you mean souvenirs." He called it a role model. So cool. But anyway, we need role models. Not the kind at the Hudson News, but we need role models in the community. How do we produce them? In my mind, on the academic side, Muslim youth that are already charismatic, they're already kind of, people gravitate towards them on campus. They're running programs at the Adam Center or other places in the area. They're already given a khutbah here and there. The sister's already running some halaqat. People know her as someone who's aspiring to learn more and is making others become more active around them, etc., etc. We have to identify those young people and we have to invest in them. We have to identify those people that are charismatic, enthusiastic about learning religion, and they're already people that others are gravitating towards. They're on their way to becoming role models for the Muslim youth anyway. The Muslim community has to identify those people, and we have to put our support behind them. Now, what does that mean, put your support behind them? I've been thinking about this for a long time for myself. How would we do that? How do you take a young person and you say the community is going to support that person? And when I say community, please understand, I don't mean the board of directors at a masjid. I don't mean that. Don't confuse the word community with an abstract group of people that meet once a week. That is not the community. Those are some elders and seniors of our community that are trying to run the organization. They are not the community. They are simply organizational members of that community that are helping administer some things. The community is families. The community is not some bureaucracy. It's families. It's you people. You're the community. So when I say you find young people and the community supports them, until you get a, don't wait for an official letterhead from the masjid. You guys have to start that conversation in your living rooms. You have to take the initiative from your homes because you are the community. You don't think that when you come into the masjid or into the center and into this gym that is getting extremely hot, until you come here, that's when you experience community. It's not true. That's not true. This community extends to every neighborhood in the area. It extends to every halal restaurant. That's where our community is. That's where the conversations are. So you identify this guy named Abdullah or this guy named Zubair, and you say, "Hey, that brother or this girl named Fatima, she's pretty smart. She's doing a lot of good for our girls. A lot of girls like to listen to her, and then she's starting youth programs and stuff. We should support Fatima. We should support Zainab." How do you support them? You open up a pathway for them for education. For the longest time, Islamic education meant we send our children abroad. So if we want our children to get a real, serious, in-depth Islamic education, we better send them to Pakistan, Bangladesh, Indonesia, Malaysia, Turkey, Saudi, Azhar, you know, Jamiat Medina, Jamiat Umul Qura in Mecca. You send them to India, you send them somewhere, Syria. Right? So many of our youth have gone abroad and studied. But it doesn't take me to tell you that the political situation in the Muslim world is pretty bad. And to send our young people over there in that turbulent environment isn't always the best idea. I know they really want to go. They really want to go. But it's not necessarily the best idea all the time. For some people, it may be the right thing. But I'm telling you, for most kids, it's not the right solution. Because they end up going there, and one of several things happen. One, they end up not learning as much as they should have. Two, they end up learning things that they cannot possibly bring back to the youth here. So they learn this text, this classical text, which is an awesome text. But when they come back to Virginia, and they come back to Texas and North Carolina, nobody cares. The youth don't want to hear about some classical text that you learned back then, and you want to sit and start a halaqah, and two people show up, and then one of them left. And the other one's your brother, and you force him to come with you, or whatever, you know. We can't teach people Islam that we want. We have to give people Islam that they need, that they're in need of, that they're experiencing. Hello. That thing, a jinn or something, I don't know. I don't mean that, I didn't mean that. I totally,
stop it.
So anyhow, somebody catch that thing. This thing is awesome. Really, you're gonna catch it? Oh my God. Karate Kid before, I know. So, what I was talking to you about, something about role models or something. There's a role model right there. But anyway, okay, getting back to the subject. What we really need is Islamic education for our young people here in America. And we need solid, intense, not just halaqas, not just seminars once in a while. We need legitimate, hardcore, intense Arabic studies, Quran studies, hadith studies, fiqh studies, sharia studies, psychology studies from the Islamic perspective, sociology studies, political science studies, Islamic history studies, seerah studies, philosophy studies from the Islamic perspective. We need those things here. Because we know what our youth face when they go into college. Oh, for that matter, what they face in high school. We know those things. So we have to create a custom catered education that we will offer to our role model youth, to our star youth from every community. We have to pick those youth out, and we have to pull them out of that their original college track for at least 2 years. My theory is 2 years. 2 years. And then after 2 years, they've built something, and then they come back and they continue their college education, no problem. They continue to go. And they do whatever they were going to do originally. If they were going to do accounting, if they were going to do architecture, if they were going to do medicine, please don't do medicine, there's enough medicine. We got enough medicine. But if they were going to do whatever other major, they'll go ahead and do it, and the community will pay for their education. There are some people who come together and say, we need you to stay here and invest yourself into this community. We're going to sponsor your Islamic education, and on top of that, we're going to sponsor your Western education, your secular education also, because we want you to stay here. And we want you to be an asset for our community. You know what the biggest need right now is across the country for masajid? It's not even imams. Our imams, we have alhamdulillah quite a few imams, may Allah reward them. But you know what the bigger need is even? Youth directors. Female youth directors, male youth directors. What are the qualifications of a youth director? What are the qualifications? Just a guy who's cool and kids like him and he plays ball with them and he knows a couple of ayat? Or have we set some sort of educational standard for this job description, which is so badly needed? And if we can create that job description, and if we can create that educational standard, then inshallah ta'ala, it's my conviction, personally, it's my conviction that this country will look like a different place. If every year we're graduating a couple of people that are versed enough in Islam, that they're not scholars, but they are effective activists. They are good, solid activists who are connected to scholars. Then you've got yourself, inshallah, a growing army of very powerful young role models that can turn the tide, that can be people of influence, that can call the youth back that are so far away from deen. They can call them back. Because the young people are, they gravitate towards other young people. Honest to God, I'm not saying this because it's not true. It is true. I don't consider myself among the youth. I'm an uncle at this point. I was playing basketball with a bunch of kids at the ISB yesterday and they said, "Hey uncle, pass me the ball." And I said, "Okay, that's it. I'm not playing anymore." But the fact of the matter is, I am a ammu, I am a chacha, I am an uncle. You guys are the youth. You guys are the youth. I used to teach Sunday school. Recently I went back to the city I used to teach Sunday school in, and the kids I taught Sunday school were getting married. And I'm like, "Oh, I'm old. Wow. You were sitting there in the third grade, picking your nose, and now you're getting married? Okay, I won't tell your wife you were picking your nose, but you know." But you guys are in fact the future. You guys are the future. And we have limited Muslim resources in this country. They're limited resources. So we have to have a serious conversation about how to make the most of those limited resources. I don't want to shamelessly sell to you a program or a service that I'm trying to offer. That's not what I'm here for. But there are a handful of educational outlets in the country that are now up and coming. Zaytuna College is up and coming. If you have the opportunity to go, and especially for the Huffaz, people that have memorized Quran, if your parents are okay with it, I'd recommend you go. I think you'll get a good education there. If you're serious about your Arabic studies, and I mean really serious about your Arabic studies, if you're ready to cry and sweat, yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you. Okay, good. Like sweat like this, yes. Which is not in a hall like this, but sweat because you work so hard. If you're ready to do that, come to me. I'll beat Arabic into you in 9 months. But you can't even come this year because our applications are closed. We're closed for the year. But anyway, what we're trying to do in Texas at least, this is what I'm excited about. What we're trying to do in Dallas, Texas is create Arabic studies for a year and then create Islamic studies with Sheikh Abdul Nasir Jangdao, with Sheikh Omar Suleiman, and so many other Imams that are there in the area. Sheikh Yasser Bridges is there, Imam Yusuf Zia Kavachi is there, you know, Imam Zia Sheikh is there, all these Sheikhs are there. So we're trying to create a 1 year of Arabic and 1 year of Islamic studies and community issues so that we produce people that can go back into their own communities. Nobody will come and save your community. Nobody from the outside. Don't look for some guy on YouTube. "Hey, we should get that guy. He should be our imam. He should be our youth director." If he's already high profile and she's already a big deal, when they come to you, they'll come to you for a year or two and then they'll be offered something somewhere else and they'll go somewhere else. That's what's going to happen. You want something from your community? What do you have to produce? Your own people. You have to invest in your own people. You have to invest in the people that have their family here. They have their roots here. They have their extended family here. They don't want to move out of here. They want to stay here. And from those youth will come the leaders for this community. This community, especially Maryland, Virginia, DC, this area particularly, in my opinion, I travel across the country, I can tell you, this area is particularly blessed with a huge number of active youth. Huge number. I mean, the amount of youth activism and volunteer force that's here for so many different programs in so many different directions is very, very impressive. It really is. With all of the problems in your community, which every community has problems, who doesn't have problems? You are sitting on treasures, you're sitting on gems. And they're sitting in the audience right next to you. You just have to identify them, have a talk with their parents, and push them in a particular direction. We need career counseling for these young people. What are they going to be doing in 6 years? And I don't want you to make your living or earn your living doing da'wah. That's not what I want you to do. I want you to be a professional in your fields, but I still want you to have a sound education in Islam. The young guys here, the young sisters here, I want you to get a sound, serious education in Islam. And I'm telling you, it is now possible. It is now possible. I am so proud, as I wrap this up, I am so incredibly proud of this year in our program in Dallas. This year, for the first time, you know, as some of you know, I've been teaching Arabic for a long time. And one of my aspirations was, man, I think I have a good way of teaching Arabic. I wish I could train other people so they could do it. They could teach in their communities, right? For the first time this year, two of my students, both sisters, One who lives in Ohio, one is actually from Texas, but she's visiting her sister in Iowa. Both of them taught the Arabic program that I'm supposed to teach in their communities to sisters. We have started producing female teachers, young sisters that are teachers for their communities. It was just a theoretical idea. Like, where do sisters go to get an education that they can give to other sisters? It's already starting to happen. I just got a picture of the classroom on my phone texted to me, and I was almost in tears. Like, subhanAllah, this is happening. It's taking place. You guys have to now think, alhamdulillah, our elders have built the masajid. They've even built us a gym, which is awesome. They've built these institutions. The Islamic schools have been built. That's been done. Now we have to build the people. It's time to build the people now. And we have to invest in those people. Every one of you knows some young person in the community that is worth investing in. I know it. I know it for a fact. But we haven't come to them and say, look, I got your back. Whatever you need to do, I got you. I'll take care of you. There are people that come out of the woodworks. I was just teaching an Arabic class in Baltimore. I'm in the middle of the Arabic class in Baltimore. And uncle came up to me and said, hey, listen, I'm this person who lives in this state. I want to buy you a campus. Why don't you just move there? I'll buy it for you. I was like, no, thanks. It's okay. No, it's ready for you. No strings attached. Just do whatever you want. Here's the campus. Hand you the keys, hand you the deed to the place. There are people like that waiting to support. But you know why he wants me to move out in the middle of nowhere? Guess why? Because he lives there. Because his kids were raised there. His friends, his family are there. He wants something for his kids and his community's kids. I respect the loyalty he has to his community. I told him, why don't you just move to Texas, bro? He's like, nuh-uh, that's my home. And I respect that. I respect that. I can't be everywhere. Imam Siraj Mahaj can't be everywhere. You know, Sheikh Omar Suleiman can't be everywhere. Sheikh Hamza Yusuf can't be everywhere. Imam Sahib can't be everywhere. They have to be in one community. But you know what? You're going to have to produce your own. I keep coming back to the same point. And until our community learns that lesson, we will continue to suffer. Every passing day that we haven't invested into our youth, there is a number of youth that we are losing. And we are losing them fast. We are losing them quickly. I know I said this the last point, but I'll take exactly 5 more minutes, I promise you. Islamic education, as we thought about it, is a completely different concept now. Just please pay attention, it's a hard one. Islamic education, as we thought about it, was all about the text. You should know some ayat, you should know some hadith, you should know some du'as, you should know some fiqh, you should know some facts about the seerah, you should know some facts about aqidah, etc., etc., etc. It was all text. It was all information. The problem with that information is, when our kids end up on online forums, or they end up on campus, they start hearing questions like, why do you even need religion? How do you even know there's a God? How are you so sure the Quran wasn't put together so much later? Here's a PhD thesis on how the Quran was put together and on the Uthmani Mus'haf or whatever. And our kids are exposed to this stuff and they're like, I don't know how to answer any of that. And then they go to the Shaykh, hopefully not in this masjid because you have qualified scholars here, but they go to the Shaykh and they say, I'm having doubts. And he says, just make more dua. Just go make wudu and the shaitan will leave you alone. Okay, yes, there's waswas of shaitan, but there's also serious intellectual challenges. Serious challenges. Why are you even Muslim? Hey, do you Muslims believe in evolution? Hey, what do you guys think about gay marriage? Do you think gay people are evil? Is that what you think? And this kid is sitting in college like, I don't know. They didn't cover that in Sunday school. I don't know. You know? You guys believe in, you know, evolution or not? I don't know. I never thought about it. Well, you guys believe in Adam and Eve, right? That doesn't make any sense. How does all this data compete with Adam and Eve? Well, I guess not. You know? What do you guys believe in? And these kids don't even know. Why am I bringing this up? Because these are the fundamental intellectual challenges to the foundations of our faith that you cannot escape. They are in our face. They are on the news. They are on campus. There are now campuses in America where they're constructing neutral bathrooms. You know what that means? Neutral bathrooms, gender neutral bathrooms. This is how powerful this movement's become. If we don't understand how Muslims are going to respond to this, if we don't have a thorough education of this ourselves, How are we going to face the modern world? We're not. These discussions have to happen inside the masjid so that our kids know how to deal with them when they go outside the masjid. They should not be faced with challenges of agnosticism and atheism and pluralism. You know, they should not be challenged with those things. When they go outside, they should already be equipped on how to respond for themselves and for others inside our four walls. We gotta build that kind of Islamic education. And I'm telling you, as much as we have to respect our tradition, traditional knowledge is powerful. It's sacred even. It's sacred. But the traditional knowledge may not answer these questions. We may have to discuss the answers to these questions based on what we find in tradition, but we have to have discussions beyond our tradition too, so that we can handle what's coming. So we can handle what's coming. It breaks my heart to tell you, I was at the ICNA convention not too long ago, which was in the East Coast, it was in Connecticut. I met a bunch of Muslim youth who came to me afterwards and said, yeah, first semester of college, I decided I'm not even a Muslim. I'm only at the convention because my parents forced me to come. I asked the girl, why are you wearing a hijab? She goes, they forced me to wear it. I'm not interested in wearing it. I don't even think Islam is a, you know, I don't. First of all, I don't believe in religion and Islam, totally not. And this is a girl from first grade to high school, Islamic school only. First grade to high school, Islamic school only. I was her first grade teacher. I knew this kid when she was in first grade. When she first came up to me and said her name, I was like, hey, I remember you. You always stuck the pencil in your nose. And she said, yeah, you know, it maybe went too far because it messed with her head. So I don't know. But on a serious note, why did that happen? It's not like she went to a bad Islamic school. That's not what happened. She learned her surah. She memorized 6 or 7 juz. She knew pretty decent Arabic. She knew a lot about the seerah. The problem was, our education was about the text, not about the challenges our children will face. They weren't about the challenges that our children will face. That has to happen. If that doesn't happen, we are in major, major trouble. Major trouble. That is what I'm proposing we have to invest in. And I'm really proud of my dear colleague, Sheikh Abdul Nasir, who's actually started the 10-month seminary. He's only accepting students that are serious about their Arabic already. They can read Arabic texts already. And they're good at that. That's his testing mechanism. And then he takes them and they go through the traditional ulum, and they go through philosophical issues, and they go through social and contemporary issues, and they go through community issues with experts over the course of 10 intense months. We do these kinds of things in Texas. And why are we doing them there? Because we live there. But you know who we're doing it for? Most of the people that are coming to us aren't from Texas. They're from everywhere else. My job is to prepare students with the Arabic. His job is to prepare the students for activism. Because you're going to need both. That's the 2-year plan. That's what we're putting together there. And if you can't come there, start working on something here. Create something that does it here. If it's already, I think there's the Qurtuba Institute here, isn't it? Support it. Strengthen it. Join it. Give them suggestions. Tell them we need this kind of program and this kind of program. And if they're doing a program, take part in it. Make it better. Stop complaining about your institutions. Build them and strengthen them. Because they're a part of your home. That's how we're going to go forward. These efforts that some people make and they start something, they cannot go further until you become a part of them. And you take them further, not just with your money, but with your time. Your time, your talents. That has to be the case. So my 5 minutes are up, inshallah ta'ala. These are the few thoughts that I thought it was important for me to share with all of you. I honestly and sincerely pray that every masjid in America thinks about, and the families are there that invest in their own youth, that see that this 2 years or 3 years of sacrifice, whatever it may be, is worth their life, the lives of their young, and also the life of that entire community and the extended families. Thank you so very much for listening. I think they have a QA session now, inshallah ta'ala. I'll stick around another 10 minutes for that.